Okay, friends, I'm glad to continue this. This should be tape number 9. We were in the middle of a discussion about Satan and his works, where he came from, and so forth, when the time ran out of the last tape. So I'm going to take up a few more thoughts on that by calling your attention, first of all, to Matthew 25 and verse 41. Here, there is a record of the words of Jesus concerning what is generally called the Great Judgment, the judgment at the last day, when all people will appear before Christ to be judged according to the works they've done in this world. And verse 46 of Matthew 25, I beg your pardon, verse 41 is the verse I want to read. Jesus says that then he will also say to those on the left hand, that's the wicked, "Depart from me, you cursed, into everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels." The reason for citing this text is to mention that the place that's commonly called hell, or the lake of fire, probably figurative terms, but in any case, words to describe a place of everlasting punishment, was not prepared for humans. It was originally prepared for Satan, if I understand the scripture correctly, a fallen angel of rank, and his following angels who rebelled against God with him. Now, some people that I've listened to and respect very highly don't agree with that. They don't agree, they don't think that there was ever such a thing as fallen angels. And if I've misunderstood these passages, I'm sorry. But that's just the best of my understanding on it. But we're going to continue just a little farther in this and discuss with you something that's recorded about Satan back over here in the old book of Job. Job chapter 1, and we're going to start in about verse 6. I believe this may help us to get a better idea of why God is letting Satan do the evil work that he does. Why God is allowing that. Let's see if we can learn something. Job chapter 1, verses 6 through 11, please. "Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. And the Lord said to Satan, 'From where do you come?' So Satan answered the Lord and said, 'From going to and fro on the earth, and from walking back and forth in it.' Then the Lord said to Satan, 'Have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him on the earth, a blameless an upright man, one who fears God and shuns evil?' So Satan answered the Lord and said, 'Does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not made a hedge around him, around his household, and around all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But now stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will surely curse you to your face.'" Now, you will probably recognize that this record concerning Job is a record about the testing that Job went through. But it is intriguing to me, I guess would be a good word, or I find it very interesting that when Satan comes into the presence of Almighty God, and God says, where have you been? He said, I've been on the earth, going here and yonder. And God said, did you notice my servant Job down there? A man that loves me, honors me, turns away from all evil, follows after my will. It almost seems to me as though God is chiding Satan, I guess would be a proper word. That he's saying to Satan, how about this man Job? See how he does the right thing? And look how you are. Look what you have fallen to. Now, I may be missing it, but it sounds that way to me. In any case, of course, Satan, being the slanderer or accuser that he is, he seeks to slander this good man, Job. And he says, yeah, he follows after you because you've got a fence around him and you won't let anything touch him. He lives an easy life. Everything he does prospers. But you take this stuff away from him and he'll curse you to your face. And so comes the test that was put upon Job. And there seems to be more to this than just the fact that Job endured the test and remained faithful. There seems to be the fact that it was an illustration that God could use to show the terribleness of the action which Satan had taken by letting it be shown by trial that here was a human who did not have near the information and had never seen near what Satan knew and had seen. But this human was following after the true and living God and continued to do so even under trials that were terribly severe. So I would suggest to you that this just may be a type of demonstration. It may very well be that God, in the whole dealings with the human race, may be putting on a demonstration for the courts of heaven, if I may use that term, the spiritual world, so that eventually God can say in the great judgment day, and which, by the way, not only will all the people that's ever lived on the earth will be at the judgment, but my understanding is that Satan and his angels will be judged there too. And not to determine whether that any of them are good or evil, or saved or lost, but to discuss and point out why they're receiving the rewards that they're receiving. And I'd call your attention to Matthew 25 for that, please. But when that happens, we're told in the Scriptures that there will be people who will, the King James says, rise up in judgment against certain generations. Jesus said of the people of his day, when he lived upon the earth, he said that the men of Sodom and Gomorrah, the wickedness was great there, but Jesus said they will rise up in judgment against that nation with whom, or that generation with whom Jesus dealt. Because he said if the people of Sodom and Gomorrah had had the opportunities and the privileges that his generation had, Sodom and Gomorrah would have repented. And he used some other illustrations. The Queen of Sheba, who came to see Solomon, would rise up in the judgment against. They would be used as a witness, or their life would be used as a testimony against the people of the day, of Jesus' day. Because Jesus said there's a far greater here than Solomon. Speaking of himself, of course. So, the scriptures speak also of the fact that Christian people will judge angels. Let me show you that, please, in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 3. You've got to give me a little more time because of this new copy that I've got here and I'm not used to it. 1 Corinthians 6, 3. Paul, the apostle of Christ, to the Christians in the city of Corinth, writes, "Do you not know that we shall judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life?" Now the context of this statement is that Paul was trying to point out to these Christian people that they were in great error when they were taking one another to court before unbelievers. In other words, there was a community of disciples here that's called the church. And some of those members of the church would bring a lawsuit against their brothers or sister and go into the courts before the world of unbelievers and accuse and try to prosecute their own brother in Christ. And Paul is trying to say that they ought to do that, that they ought to be able to set up some man or men of their own assembly to settle matters that they have, where they had disagreements, instead of going to a civil court. And in that context, Paul says, "Do you not know that the saints will judge angels, or do you not know that Christian people will be used in the judgment as an example to reprove and point out the total rebellion that the angels carried out, even though the humans had less opportunity and less knowledge, had seen less?" Now, I think that's what he's talking about. So, I'm just wondering that it may very well be that God is allowing this dispensation to run its course and giving us the opportunity to choose good or evil, and allowing Satan to go about his evil work, so that in the end, in the final judgment, in the final analysis, that God is going to be able to, if you please, go before the courts of heaven and say, "Look, I was just in doing what I've done. These rebellious angels have not done the right thing. They didn't even do as well for their opportunity as these humans who lived on the earth in physical bodies and subject to all those trials and temptations." Now, I guess I better get off of that, but you think on those things, please, and see what you can learn about it. In the final analysis, though, friends, the fact is that Satan is real. He is active today. Whether I'm right about the whys and wherefores is immaterial when we get to that part. Because 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8 says that Satan in the Christian age, when Peter was writing to Christian people of that day, he said Satan was walking about like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. The picture given is that Satan is like a hungry beast prowling and looking for his prey. And Peter warned his Christian brethren that they ought to be on guard and use all of the protections that God has given to us in order to avoid that terrible predator called Satan. In Luke chapter 22 and verse 31, Jesus, speaking to Peter, by the way, said, Satan hath desired to have you so that he may sift you like wheat. Now, if you were ever around the old timey days when they gathered, harvested the wheat and brought it in the sheaves and laid it on the big old flat rock, and then take a thing called a flail, a pole, wooden pole about yay long, and on the end of it be a piece of rope, short a section of rope, and have another section of pole about so long, so that it would flop. And the people would take that pole and they would wipe it against that rock with all of those sheaves of wheat on it, and they would that would pound those kernels out of the wheat heads. And then they would throw that up in the wind, and the wind blow the chaff away and catch the wheat. Then they'd take it and grind it up. And then, of course, sift it again through a fine sieve so they could have the finer flour and not have all that wheat bran in there. So I've got a suspicion that the whole operation was in mind here when Jesus said Satan would like wants to have you so he might sift you like wheat. He wanted to frail him to little pieces and then grind him up and then sift him out as one would do wheat to make flour. And Satan had some bad ideas and things that he wanted to do to Peter. But Jesus said, I prayed for you. And Satan wasn't glad to do that. Although Peter did endure terrible persecutions and stand a lot of trials. All right. Now, this then gives us a picture of this one that's called in Genesis 1, the serpent. And in Genesis 3:1 is the first mention of his evil work. When he came into the garden, and he is said to be coming in the form of a serpent, because that beast was more subtle or more cunning than any beast of the field. And by the way, Satan is a master of disguise. I better turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and read you something that Paul had to say about that in what we call 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Verse 13 through 15. Paul is talking about some people he called false apostles and deceitful workers, and how that they put themselves off and out to be true apostles of Christ. Let me read to you. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostles of Christ. They were not what they appeared to be. They were just representing themselves as apostles. And then Paul says, and no wonder, for Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. Therefore it is of no great thing if his ministers also transform themselves into ministers of righteousness, whose end will be according to their works. So, Paul said Satan could transform himself into what are called angels of light. You know, when Satan approaches a person, it won't be a frightful experience. This concept of Satan as an all red beast with horns and a great long tail is propaganda, my friends. And Satan is the master of that too, by the way. I'm sorry about that break. Somebody knocked on the cabin door. Sometimes you just can't win. We were talking about people having the idea that Satan is red all over and got horns and a great long tail, but that he's not that way. He nor his servants have that appearance. When Satan approaches you, it won't be a frightening experience, friends. It'll be in a subtle, shy manner, or sly manner. And it'll be one of the most beautiful things you ever saw. Or maybe it'll be just that he's enticing you to do just a little bit of something wrong at first, and then grow to bigger things. And so now we see Satan approaching Eve. And with the background that we have read about Satan, I'm going to suggest to you an imaginary conversation. Just my imagination of how Satan might have approached Eve. Before we do that, I'm going to read to you from Genesis chapter 3, right quickly. And I'm afraid I'm going to run out of time again, but if I do, can't help it. Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, "Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?" And the woman said to the serpent, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die." Then the serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die. For God knows that in the day that you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Then the Lord called Adam and said to him, "Where are you?" So he said, "I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." So that quick reading right there, and we're going to come back to that, the Lord willing, in the next tape. But I want to just give you an idea, my imagination, of how this conversation might have gone between Adam and Eve. Between Satan and Eve. But I'm going to have to do it when I come back on the next tape, for our time's running out. Thank you for listening. In our last tape, we read rather hurriedly the record in Genesis chapter 3 concerning the serpent coming to Eve and tempting her to eat of the forbidden fruit, and how that she believed the lie and ate the fruit, gave her husband, and he did eat. And I want to go back to that and try to give you sort of an imaginary conversation as I would imagine it taking place between Eve, between Satan and Eve. I hope that, by doing this, I can sort of illustrate for especially the young people. We older ones need to know it too, but especially for the young people, how Satan is so cunning and how he would approach us and how I can imagine he might have approached Eve. Let's say it's a beautiful morning in the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve are enjoying all the blessings that are available for them. And here comes this creature called a serpent. And Satan, working in him or through it, whatever you want to call it, comes casually walking through the garden. At first, pretending perhaps that he might mosey on by and not even take notice of Eve standing there. But just as he is about to pass her by, he turns and speaks very politely. "Morning, Eve. How's things been going?" "Oh, just wonderful, thank you, wonderful. You like it here, do you?" "Oh, yes, it's the most beautiful, glorious place imaginable." "How's the food, Eve? You like it pretty well?" "Oh, yes, the food's great, just wonderful. God lets you eat anything you want, does he?" "Well, anything we want, except that tree over there in the middle of the garden, we're not to eat of it. God said not to even touch it. Said if we do, we'll die." Satan ever so casually turns and looks at the tree and says, "Huh, ain't nothing to that." He moves a little closer to the tree and Eve follows. Satan continues, "Boy, that sure is a beautiful thing." He stares at the tree for several seconds. "Yeah, that sure is pretty." Now he turns and looks at Eve straight in the eye. His facial expressions have changed. He is now a very serious character, but showing great concern. He speaks, "Eve, I'm just going to tell you the truth about this tree and about God. God knows that when you eat this fruit, you will experience things you've never dreamed of. You talk about a trip, man, it's out of this world. And the secret is, Eve, God doesn't want you to be like him and enjoy what he enjoys. When you eat this fruit, you're going to see things that you never saw before and never even imagined. You're going to know and understand things that you never knew before. And God doesn't want you to have that experience." Without a word, another word, Satan turns and slowly leaves the scene. Eve stands staring at the beautiful fruit. After a few seconds, maybe a minute or two, she stretches out her hand and takes the fruit and eats it. She hands the rest to her husband with her, and he eats also. Just an imaginary conversation, just my own human thoughts about what it might have been like. However the conversation went exactly, I can assure you that Satan didn't come stomping into the garden one morning, walking over the plants and knocking things around, and walk up to Eve and say, "Let me tell you something. Here's what you're going to have to do. You're going to have to eat the fruit." No, he's too cunning for that. He comes on the sly. And he uses the same tactics today that he used back then. Now, I want to go back to Adam for a minute. I never had thought of this until a year or so ago when I heard a man preaching on the radio. And he talked about Adam's part in this situation we're discussing. And I'd never noticed it before. But the text says that after Eve ate of the forbidden fruit, she gave unto her husband with her. Apparently, Adam was there on the scene through the whole deal. It sure sounds that way in the text. And if he was, there's no record that Adam ever raised an objection. And there's no indication that he looked at the serpent and said, "Hey, you leave my wife alone." Or said to Eve, "Now Eve, you know that God is good to us. He's given us all these good things. You mustn't listen to this serpent." Seems to have taken no initiative whatsoever. Now again, I don't know that that's the correct understanding of it, but it appears that way. And for sure, once Eve ate of the fruit, she just turned and handed him some of it, and he ate. Now, suddenly, their eyes are opened. And they're filled with shame and guilt. And you talk about a trip. Now they're taking one. They hear God coming in the garden. And no telling how many times God had come and visited with them. And they were thankful to have him with them in the garden, and they enjoyed one another's presence and fellowship. But this time, when they heard God coming, they ran and they hid. And God called out, said, "Adam, where are you?" And he said, "Well, I heard you coming, and I ran and hid because I was naked." And God said, "Who told you you were naked? Did you eat of that tree?" And now we're going to take up reading here in Genesis 3 again. We're going to see something here that is amazing. To see how God taught and asked each one of the three that were involved. First to Adam, then to Eve, and then the serpent. Then the Lord called to Adam and said, I'm reading verse 9, of chapter 3 in Genesis. Where are you? So he said, I heard your voice in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. And he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree of which I commanded you that you should not eat? Then, now watch him. Then the man said, the woman whom you gave me to be with me, she gave me of the tree and I ate. Now watch, Adam tries to lay the blame on his wife. And he almost does imply that it was partly God's fault because God had given him the woman to start with. The woman whom you gave to be with me, God, she gave me of the tree, and I ate. Then the Lord turns to the woman and says, what is this that you have done? The woman says, the serpent deceived me, and I ate. So the Lord now turns to the serpent and he says, because you have done this, you are cursed more than all cattle and more than every beast of the field. On your belly you shall go and you shall eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman and between her seed. I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head and you shall bruise his heel. Now, let's stop right there just a minute. I'm going to read some more here. But this passage here in Genesis 3:15 is seen by many as the promise of something that was going to come way on down here on this timeline. Because it speaks of the seed of the woman. Now that's contrary to common language. It's usually the seed of the man. That God was going to put enmity or ill will, warlike between the woman, her seed, and Satan. Let me read it again. I will put enmity between you and the woman. That is, you're speaking to the serpent. Between the serpent and the woman. And between the serpent's seed and her seed. He, the seed of woman, shall bruise your heel. And you shall bruise, did I read it wrong? He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel. The head being a major mortal wound, the heel a less harmful, minor wound. Now, when we get way down here on this chart, the Lord willing, later on, I hope to come back to that, and maybe we'll bring that to your attention, but I hope you'll keep it in mind. Then he turns and goes on and talks to the woman. He says, I will greatly multiply your sorrow and your conception. In pain you shall bring forth children. Your desire shall be for your husband, and he will rule over you. And then to Adam he says, because you have heeded the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree of which I commanded you, saying, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for your sake. And toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Both thorns and thistles it shall bring forth for you, and you shall eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread, till you return to the ground, for out of it you are taken, for dust you are, and to dust you shall return. What a sad and pitiful day it was when God saw his creatures that he had so lovingly brought into this world and fixed such a wonderful place for them and given them all those blessings, and had to see them turn away and believe a lie and thus separate themselves from God. Now, somebody will say, that's a good point to bring that out, a good place to bring this point out. Somebody will ask, well, they didn't die. Oh, but they did, my friend. Death is but a separation. We talked earlier about the body and the spirit. Physical death is the separation of the spirit from the body. Spiritual death is the separation of man from God. And these people died spiritually the day that they ate of the fruit. But later, they would die physically because they'd been cast out of the garden, away from the tree of life, as a result of their spiritual death. So they died later physically. Now, I want to bring out another thing here, please, and mention to you that because of this curse that was put on the earth, upon man and woman and the serpent, we have tragedies and suffering and misery in this world. This is a sin-cursed earth. Little babies die. Good people get sick and suffer terrible things. Young mothers and fathers die and leave little children. And sometimes we can't understand these things. Sometimes people try to give the best explanations they can think of, and they'll say things like, well, God just thought that little baby was so beautiful that God just wanted that little baby to go home with him and live with him. People who say things like that mean well, but my dear friends, the scriptures don't bear that out. Little babies die because this is a sin-cursed earth. Because we have lived in a broken world where there's now disease and harms on every hand. And it's not particularly because any certain individual has sinned, but because we're all under the curse. So I hope you'll keep that in mind. Now, I want also to bring to your attention that according to the record in Genesis, the farther that man went as he left God, the worse he got. Now you always keep that in mind. When we depart from God's way, the farther we go, the worse it gets. Man does not have the ability to guide his own steps. And when we leave God, we're going down all the way. And as we come on through this Genesis record, we find the story of Cain killing his brother Abel. The two children of Adam and Eve, and one of them killed the other. And by the time we get into the sixth chapter of Genesis, we find a number of years have passed by, but the earth has become so corrupt that it is just filled with violence. And I'm going to start reading in chapter 6 of Genesis about verse 5. And we have this sad story. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. So the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, creeping thing, and birds of the air, for I am sorry that I have made them. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Now I'll stop there just for a minute. Here was a situation where the men had gotten so corrupt that the earth was filled with violence. Men just didn't seem to have any ability left to have a good thought. Rotten to the core. And God looks down on it and he said, I just can't take it anymore. I'm going to do away with all of it. But there was this one man named Noah. And he was married and he had three sons. And God looked down on Noah and he said, "Why, there's a man that's trying to the best of his ability in his generation to follow my will." And the text says, Noah found grace. That is, the undeserved kindness of God. Noah didn't really deserve it because Noah was a sinner. But he was not a sinner to the degree of those around him. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But Noah wanted to do what God's will was. And God didn't overlook him. Now that's one of the most wonderful points that I will be able to make in these tapes. I want you to understand, friends, that the day may come when you will feel like that you're all alone in the world. But always remember that God is mindful of you. God loves you. And he cares for you. And the time may come that you feel that you're the only person in your family that's trying to serve the Lord. Or you may think that you're the only one in your whole school or the whole factory where you work that's trying to live right. Wickedness may grow to the point where that you just don't know of anybody in your whole county or state that's trying to call upon the name of the Lord and seek after the Lord. Yea, my friends, if all men of all the world turn their back on God, if you alone are still trying to serve God to the best of your ability and clinging to Him, God will not overlook you. He will not forget you. He will not forsake you and leave you. He knows your heart and mind, and he will not forget us. Please remember that. Please hold to that in all the days of your life. And never, never be overcome with the feeling of loneliness. Because always know that there is a God in heaven. And he loves me and cares for me, and he will not let me be forgotten. He will not overlook me. Now, let's go a little farther in this reading here about the condition of the world. Verse 11 of Genesis 6 says, "The earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence." So God looked down upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt, flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. And God said to Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them. And behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Make yourself an ark of gopher wood. Make rooms in the ark and cover it inside and outside with pitch. And then he starts telling him how large to build the ark and what dimensions, so forth. And verse 17 says, and behold, I myself am bringing floodwaters on the earth to destroy from under heaven all flesh in which is the breath of life. Everything that is on the earth shall die. But I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall go into the ark, you, your sons, and your wife, and your sons' wives with you. Now, there is a marvelous scene. It's marvelous in the sad part. It's marvelous in the good part. As we said a while ago, the earth was corrupt. God said, I'm going to destroy it all. But Noah was trying to do right, and God said, and God didn't forget him. God said, now here's what I want you to do. I want you to build an ark. It's a big old square, a big old rectangular box, boat of a thing. And he tells him, I want you to make it out of gopher wood. I want you to do this, and I want you to do that. I want you to put this pitch on the inside and the outside and all that. And he tells him how to do it. Now, try to picture, if you will, please, this scene. Here is Noah and his family, and God reveals this information to him. He says, Noah, I'm going to destroy every living, breathing thing on the earth. But here is what I want you to do, so that you and your family can be spared, and I will make a covenant with you. I told you earlier that God's made a lot of covenants with people all the ages. We're going to see a covenant that God makes with Noah. You build this ark. I'm going to tell you how to get the animals and so forth and so on put in the ark. And I'm going to spare you and your family. Now, the text tells us that God said that he would give men 120 years to repent. God said, I'm not always going to strive and plead with these people. But yet their days shall be 120 years. And as far as I can understand it, Noah spent no telling how many years building this ark, and at the same time trying to warn the people of the world about what was going to happen. Can you imagine the frustrations that he must have faced day after day, week upon month upon year after year, working on this ark? And no doubt people would come by, and there he was building this big ark on dry land, and they would say, Noah, what are you doing? He would say, people, God's going to bring a flood on the earth and destroy all things that breathe. And they would look at Noah, and a big old grin would come across their face, and then they'd just burst out laughing and just hold their sides and almost fall over laughing and say, Noah, you have no mind left. And on the way they'd go, year after year. My friends, we're going to take that study a little farther when we come back in our next tape. And we want to go back into Hebrews and talk about how that Noah is described as a preacher of righteousness, and how that by faith Noah, moved with fear, built an ark to the saving of his house. But our tape's about to run out now, and the Lord willing, we'll take up with that in the next one. I really appreciate you viewing these, and I cannot express how much I thank you. going to try it again.
We've had a few encouraging comments, and that sort of encouraged us and spurred us on to continue this effort. I appreciate all the fine help that we're being given. I want to go back now to the flood on our chart back in Genesis chapter 6, where we were talking about Noah and how that God saw the wickedness of the world and was planning to destroy all things, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord and told Noah, said, I'm going to destroy the earth. And I'm going to bring a great flood. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to build an ark and so forth. But now, at this point, I want to try to look at this from Noah's human standpoint, our viewpoint. And in order to do that, I want to read a number of passages from this collection of writings that we've been referring to, called the Bible. And the first one I would like to read is in Genesis chapter 2. It's just very possible, according to this passage, that Noah may have never seen a rain. Now, again, I could be mistaken about this, but I'm going to read it in your hearing and see how it sounds to you. Genesis chapter 2, verses 5 through 6. I'm reading in the New King James Version. Verse 5. I'll go ahead and read verse 4. I'm mixed up there. Genesis 2, 4 through 6. This is the history of the heavens and the earth when they were created in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens. Before any plant of the field was in the earth, and before any herb of the field had grown. For the Lord God had not caused it to rain on the earth, and there was no man to till the ground. But a mist went up from the earth and watered the face of the ground. And then it goes on talking about it making Adam and then planting the garden in eastward in Eden and so forth. Now, I don't know for sure whether that would indicate that there was a time after God created plants on the earth that they were watered by some sort of fog or mist on a regular basis, or whether he's saying that the earth was still dry and not suitable for a plant to grow in. I guess you could debate it either way, but it just sort of sounds like, at least, that there may have been a period of time when the earth was watered by sort of a fog or a mist, and it kept it just a certain ideal amount of moisture all the time. That would fit in with the nature of all God's creation, and that it was good and perfect. So I'm just going to take that view of it for the sake of this discussion right now. And if that is the case, it would shed a little light on what's said back over here in one of the letters that we have, that we talked about, the Hebrews, the letter to the Hebrews. And I'm going to read from the 11th chapter of Hebrews. And the author there is talking about a great list of people who had faith in God, and that faith caused them to obey God
And one in that list is Noah. And so I read from Hebrews 11, verse 7. Now I'm going to read out of the King James Version, the original King James. Hebrews 11, verse 7. By faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world, and became heir of righteousness, which is by faith. Now I'm going to take the time to turn over here in this New King James translation and read that same passage for you. I'm going to read several passages right here in the beginning of this tape, but I don't want to take the time to read all in both translations, but I'm hoping to introduce you to this a little bit more clearly and see if I can create enough interest that you'll take the effort to get you a copy of this new King James translation and compare it with the original. I'm not used to this new copy. I'm sorry. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. Now I read it again in your hearing. By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not seen yet. I beg your pardon, it's hard for me to read it in a different wording. By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, moved with godly fear, prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. Now, you'll notice that the text says that God, our divinity, divine nature, warned Noah of things not yet seen. Now, again, I don't know whether that would just mean that Noah had never seen a universal flood and all the accompanying disaster that came with it. Or it could just possibly go back to what we were talking about earlier about the rain. It's just possible that Noah never had even seen it rain. But in any case, he had never seen anything like God told him was going to take place. And that is to Noah's credit when we find that he had enough faith in what God said to him to go ahead and take the action that God wanted him to take. Now I'm going to read from 2 Peter, a letter, one of the two letters that we have written by the Apostle Peter. And Peter discusses this thing about Noah. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5. Starting right in the middle of the text here, where he's talking about Noah and how that God did not spare the ancient world, but saved Noah, one of eight people, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood on the world of the ungodly. Now, I cite that passage because here Peter describes Noah as being a preacher of righteousness. Now there again, one might say, well, he proclaimed a message by his obedience in building the ark. That may very well be the case. I'd say it was true. I mean, it was an example to the world. But I would suggest it probably indicates more than that, Noah actually delivered this message that had come to him to people that were around him and in his part of the world. When they would ask him, of course, what he was doing, he would try to tell them. And he may have stood there beside the ark proclaiming to the passers-by, this is what God's going to do. In any case, he's called a preacher of righteousness. Now, I want to go back to Genesis, and this time read from the 6th chapter of Genesis and verse 3. Now, there's a reason for doing all this reading. I hope you'll bear with me just a minute. I'm going to try to draw some conclusions here in a few minutes. Genesis chapter 6 and verse 3. Now, this is a statement made prior to the statement where God speaks to Noah and warns him about the destruction to come. And it seems that it's basically God, he is talking how God said a thing almost like we'd say we talk to ourselves. That may sound strange to you, but anyway, God had saw the wickedness of the world, and Genesis 6, 3 says, and the Lord said, my spirit shall not strive with man forever, for he is indeed flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. Now, I've got an idea here, and I'm pretty sure on this, that God was saying things are bad on the earth, but I'm going to give the people 120 more years to try to see if they'll do anything about it, if they'll change. You always see when you're reading the scriptures of God dealing with wickedness, that I say you'll always see, but in general, the places that I can recall, when God is planning to bring judgment on a certain person or people, that he would give some time, like when he sent Jonah to the city of Nineveh, and he said, yet 40 days and I will destroy Nineveh. We're going to see a little bit later in our discussion of the call of Abraham that God promised Abraham he was going to give him some land where Abraham was a sojourner, a traveler there, a pilgrim. And God said basically to Abraham, I can't give this to you personally. I'll give it to your descendants, and it's going to be a 400 years before I can give it to them. And the reason God was delaying it, because he said the wickedness of the nations that lived in that land was not yet full. I don't want to get off on that too far, but as I said, God generally gives people plenty of time to repent, but then there comes eventually a time when he says, okay, time's up. And we're going to see that here in the case of the flood. So, I'm trying to make the case that, number one, Noah had never seen the type of thing that God said was going to happen. Secondly, Noah was a preacher of righteousness. And thirdly, from the time that God decided to destroy the earth, it appears that he said, I'm going to give the world 120 years. Now, exactly how long it was after that that God spoke to Noah, I'm not real sure. But let's just say, for the sake of illustration, that God, and it sounds like that God spoke to Noah about it pretty soon here in the record. Say he did. Go ahead and tell Noah that I'm going to destroy the earth, and you get this ark ready and so forth. But knowing that it was going to be 100 or 120 years before the actual judgment of the world came in the great flood. Now look at what that sets us up for here. You take Noah's situation now as a human, just as human and weak and subject to temptations as I am or as you are. And God gives Noah this warning. Think about, first of all, Noah's concern for his relatives and associates, friends and neighbors. That must have been a very heart-rending thing. God had said to Noah, I'm going to kill everything that breathes on the earth. All the people and the animals and everything. And then that brings up another subject. What about Noah's property? All his flocks and herds or whatever he had. Was he going to lose that? Well, yeah, sure was. He's going to have to give that up. And then think about the labor, the work, and the expense involved in building this ark, this huge boat, rectangular box of a thing that was 450 feet long, 75 feet wide, and 45 feet high. Now, you can't set that in a football field. Not near it. And that's based on the assumption that the cubit that God told Noah to use as a measurement was about 18 inches. Some say it was more like 2 feet long, 24 inches, or some even argue there was such a thing as called a cubit of a man's stature or height. I don't know, but whatever it was a big outfit, and it took a lot of work and a lot of time and a lot of expense to build it. And then you think about the ridicule, which we mentioned a little bit earlier. What would people say? Everyone could see this construction project going on. The questions had to come and they had to be answered. And then the jokes that had to be passed around, no doubt, about crazy old Noah and his boat here on dry land. And I'm suggesting to you that it's possible, from what I can read in the scriptures, that this may have gone on for better than 100 years. If that's the case, Noah preached 120 years and never made a convert. That is, unless you count his family. If they be counted converts, then I suggest to you he did a whole lot better. Noah did a whole lot better than most men can do today. If we can do as well as Noah did to save himself, his wife, his three sons, and their wives, it'll be a blessing. But outside of that, he never made another convert. Lost everybody. Now I just wonder, I'm trying to make these things as real to you as I possibly can, to let you see them from a human standpoint. And so try to imagine what it would have been like if we had been in Noah's situation. And let's say that Noah completed this ark. Say it took him 20 years to build this ark. I don't know how long it would have taken. Say it took him 20 years, or even 40 years, if you want to. But whatever it was, there set this ark on dry land. Maybe for 80 or 100 years. Maybe he had it up on some kind of big scaffolding so that he could keep the pitch renewed there on the outside and on the inside. Keep it all caulked and fixed just like God was telling him to. Or had told him to. I don't know that that's a fact, but it seems very possible that that situation could have existed. So there it said, as a warning sign of the impending doom that was to come upon the earth. It would have been bigger than one of these great big billboards along the side of the highway. It would just have been as though there would be a huge billboard going into Nashville over here on the side of I-24. And it would say, yet just in a little while, God's going to send a flood and destroy the whole earth. There it stood as a warning to the world. Now, there would also be the constant anxiety that we mentioned a while ago for Noah's relatives and good friends and people that he was concerned about year after year. And he's pleading and he's teaching. He's praying. But the people just keep on mocking and ridiculing him. Where's your flood, Noah? Look at the big old boat there. What are you going to do with that? Burn it for firewood? And it would get worse and worse as every year went by. 5 years after he finished, 20, 30 years, 70 years maybe it stood there. Noah taking care of it. Noah saying God's going to bring a flood. And everybody laughing. Maybe Noah, if he was anywhere near as weak as I am, after about 50 or 60 or 70 years, Noah might have started thinking, you reckon I understood correctly what God said to me? You reckon that I could have got mixed up on that? Everybody says I'm crazy. Maybe there's something wrong. Imagine, friends, the faith and the patience it took for Noah to just hang on all those years. And as far as I can find in the scriptures, there's no record where God ever spoke to Noah again after he told him what God was going to do and what he wanted Noah to do about building the ark and so forth. Until the time when it was time for Noah to go on the ark. But Noah kept trying to hang on. And again, I want to try to just make this as real as I possibly can. And I was making some of these notes early one morning here a while back, and everything's quiet. And I got to thinking, what if, say, after 50 or 60 years, Noah might have awakened in the wee hours of the morning and couldn't go back to sleep? He thought, well, I'll just get up and go out and check on the ark. I'd see him out there alone, so small beside the huge craft that he and his family and whoever they could hire had built. I see him standing there and he strokes his hand along one of the rough-hewn boards. Suddenly, he's overcome with fears and doubts. He leans against the ark. His eyes fill with tears and he prays, oh Lord, if I could just get another word from you on this situation. I've not heard anything from you in so long. And everybody's making fun of me. I'm getting a little bit worried about whether I've understood you correctly. Maybe God might have spoke to him. Maybe God didn't speak to him. I don't know. Maybe God never said, or maybe Noah never had a problem like this. But whatever the situation was, if Noah went through that, he had to gather his strength and his courage. There was a great sigh, turn and go back to his dwelling, and lay down by his wife, and try to get some rest. As I said, this is human, based on human nature and my imagination. But whatever the situation was that Noah went through, I assure you, it was plenty rough. Finally, one day, probably very, very unexpectedly, God said to Noah, "Noah, it's time. Get in the ark. Get your stuff together. 7 more days are left, and I'm going to bring this flood and destroy the earth." And don't you know that Noah just jumped and started rushing around to get everything in the ark that he lacked, and to get all the animals in there, get everything tied down and packed away. How wonderful it must have been for Noah to hear the voice of God again and to be reassured that he had properly understood, that he had done what God wanted him to do. But yet at the same time, how terrible it must have been for Noah to suddenly be faced with the fact that all my close relatives except my wife, 3 sons, and their wives are going to perish in just a few days. People that Noah had lived with and known for years and years, people maybe that had worked on the ark because he paid them to work. It makes me tremble, my friends, to think about all those years that Almighty God had been waiting patiently while Noah, by faith, labored on and bore the scorn of a wicked world who would not repent. Then suddenly there came the voice of God, and he said, "Noah, it's time to get in the ark. Go, man. Do what I've told you to do. Get in the ark." And Noah went. He takes the last provisions, as we said, everything that he needs. The people around him, the community, seeing this sudden flurry of activity, "Look," they say, "look at old Noah. He's planned this out to the very end. He's hauling his stuff in that big boat." And I wonder, again, I just think about things like this from a human standpoint. I wonder if a few people may have begun to think if there might really be something to this flood business that Noah's been talking about all these years. Maybe a family or two discussed going over to Noah's place and asking if they could find out what they needed to do to get in this ark, to board the ark with Noah and his family. Maybe they decided after discussing it that they'd do something about it next week. Yeah, maybe next week, week or 10 days, a couple of weeks at the most, we'll go over there and we'll talk to Noah about it. I think there might have been some wife, some woman that said to her husband, "Let's go over there and talk to Noah and his wife about this thing that he's been preaching." And her husband harshly mocked her and said, "Are you crazy, woman? There's nothing to what that old man says. He's been saying that for 100 years. And she said, I guess you're right. I was foolish. And that's the end of it. 7 days passed, my friend. Noah and his family and all the possessions that they were to take and all the animals they were to take are in the ark. And the text says God closed the door on the ark. Can you hear me? Did you get that, please? The text says God closed the door. It was all over. 120 years to repent. Now, all opportunity is past. No deals. Judgment had come. And as I said earlier, there always seems to be the same pattern. Always the warning. Then time to repent. Then opportunity is past, and there's no deals. I find it so strange that we ran out of time on that last tape when we were so intently trying to make the point that when God warns people of impending doom, He gives them time to repent. And then time runs out. How strange it was. We take up where we left off. God has closed the door of the ark. Then it begins to rain. And my friend, it was no spring shower. Panic begins to grip the hearts of the general population. But the great philosophers philosophized, and the religious leaders spoke calming words. And the officials of the government issued regular reports assuring all that they were in control of the situation. But the water kept rising. The text in Genesis says that the fountains of the deep were broken up. Most people who have studied this conclude that there were terrible earthquakes and volcanic action. The seabeds rose up, higher ground sank. There were huge, tremendous tidal waves involved in all this. But as the water began to rise and the earth began to tremble, huge throngs no doubt surged toward the ark. But my friends, it was too late. The day of salvation had passed. God had shut the door, and no man could open it. The ark creaked and groaned slightly and lifted off the ground. Now at that point, I want to read again to you from the record in Genesis. Genesis chapter 7, verse 19 through 23. Genesis 7, verses 19 through 23. And the waters prevailed exceedingly on the earth. All the high hills under the whole heaven were covered. The waters prevailed 15 cubits upward, and the mountains were covered. And all flesh died that moved on the earth. Birds and cattle and beasts and every creeping thing that creeps on the earth, and every man in whose nostrils was the breath of the Spirit of life. All that was on the dry land died. So He destroyed all living things which were on the face of the ground, both man and cattle, creeping thing and bird of the air. They were destroyed from the earth. Only Noah and those who were with him in the ark remained alive. So the waters prevailed exceedingly upon the earth. All that breathed died, except Noah, his wife, his three sons, and their wives. The water prevailed upon the earth for over a year, if I remember correctly. Noah and his family drifting aimlessly on the surface. Finally, the waters receded, God causing this to take place as he caused it to rise. The ark came to rest, and Noah and his family stepped forth into a new world and a new start. Now I'll read again, and I wish I'd kept my place open there. Genesis chapter 6, starting in verse 18. We start to see a brighter picture here now. Genesis 6, verse 18. God says to Noah, I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall go into the ark, you, your sons, your wife, and your sons' wives with you. Now, of course, this is before he went into the ark and while God was warning him. But I wanted to read it because it says that God would make a covenant with Noah. Remember I told you, I showed you that God made a covenant with Adam. Now he's making a covenant with Noah, even before he goes in the ark. And then he's going to elaborate on that covenant after they get out of the ark. This time I read from Genesis 9, 3 through 7. God speaking to Noah now after they come out of the ark. He says, every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. I have given you all things, even as the green herbs, but you shall not eat flesh with its life, that is, its blood. Surely for your life blood I will demand a reckoning from the hand of every beast I will require it, and from the hand of man, from the hand of every man's brother I will require the life of man. Whosoever sheds man's blood, by man his blood shall be shed. For in the image of God he made man. And as for you, be fruitful and multiply. Bring forth abundantly in the earth and multiply in it. And God spoke to Noah and to his sons with him, saying, and as for me, behold, I establish my covenant with you and with your descendants after you. So, here's some of the words that God gave to Noah as the covenant that he was making with Noah and his family. He tells them several things that we read about here. For example, they were able to eat meat now. They could kill animals and eat the flesh, but they were not to eat it with the blood. In this same text, he says there's going to be a penalty for murder. And the penalty under that covenant was that if a man killed somebody, that murderer had to pay with his life. And then he also says for Noah and his family to be fruitful and multiply, to have children and replenish the earth. Now, it's significant here that we realize that God, as I said, had earlier made a covenant with Adam and Eve. And that original covenant with them was that they were to eat only vegetables and fruit. They were not to eat flesh. There wasn't any killing in the original world. They were to dress and keep the garden. They were not to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And they were to be fruitful and multiply. And I forgot to mention that in the earlier tape when we were talking about God's covenant with Adam and Eve. And a lot of people have the concept that Adam and Eve would have never had any children if they had not sinned. I don't think the scriptures teach that. They were commanded in the very beginning when God put them in the garden to be fruitful and multiply. I think there's some evidence that they would not have had near as many children, and it wouldn't have been painful and as horrible as it is for a woman to give birth under this cursed system. But sorry about that, but I felt I need to bring that out. Now, Noah, the point I'm trying to show you here is that Noah could not go back and was not expected to go back and live under the covenant that God had made with Adam and Eve. It was a different situation and a different covenant. Now, it was wrong for Cain to kill his brother. It was contrary to God's nature and God's law. And God punished Cain for it. And God comes on into the covenant that he made now with Noah, and he forbids one man to kill another one, and said, if one man kills another man, then that the murderer is to be killed. And when he gave the covenant to Adam, he could only eat vegetables and fruit. But in the case of Noah, he could eat the meat. Now, there could have been somebody, I don't want to hammer this too much, but I hope it's going to be very valuable to us in later studies. There could have been people that were born a little few years after Noah came out of the ark. Say 20 or 30 years, somebody grows up and says, now Noah, I saw you kill a lamb over there the other day and cook that thing and eat it, and I just don't believe we ought to do that. And I'm going to tell you why. Because I remember hearing you say one time that God had told Adam and Eve that they were just to eat the fruits and vegetables. So how come, Noah, that you're eating the flesh of animals? Well, all Noah had to do was say, now, well, look here, here's where you're misunderstanding here, young fella, is when I came out of the ark with my family, God plainly told me that I could eat meat, but I wasn't supposed to drink the blood with it or eat the meat with the blood in it. So there's a change in the covenant. I hope you'll keep that in mind, because that's going to be very important to us when we get farther along on this chart down here. I hope we're going to see some things there. Now, there was a new world here before us, as they came out into this cleansed earth. Everything was purified, and God had taken the best that the human race had to offer and spared that one family. And they come out of the ark into the new world under a new covenant. And my friends, you don't have to go far. It is absolutely amazing. You come right into the 9th chapter of Genesis, in the 20th verse, and you read that text, and I won't read it in your hearing, but you can read it. It tells how Noah planted a vineyard, and he made some wine out of the grapes, and he drank so much of it that he got drunk. And there was a bad scene that took place there and wound up in Noah pronouncing a curse upon one of his own sons. And I have to ask myself, How could this have possibly happened? How could a man that had endured what Noah endured, who had been as faithful as Noah was, a preacher of righteousness, how could he have done a thing like this? And I suggest to you that the lesson we learn from this is that man cannot save himself. Man will not and cannot save himself. You go a little farther, come into the 11th chapter of Genesis, and you see that man's on a downhill drive again. Going down and leaving God. Whole big bunch of the people, after several generations or whatever they are, they begin to make this plan, and they're going to undertake a big engineering project and build them a tower that will reach to heaven. They're going to make their own way to go to heaven. God comes down and confuses their language and scatters them over the face of the earth and so forth. But I want to suggest to you, my friends, that this shows us that I don't care how we try or what systems we devise, we'll never, never be able to restore ourselves back into fellowship with Almighty God, our Creator. Never will we accomplish it on our own. And yet that is taught all through this record or this collection of writings that we have. Now, man makes some wonderful accomplishments. And a lot of them I'm very thankful for. Technology and mass production has made life much more convenient and comfortable. And the right kind of education is great. Medicine, the medical field has made marvelous progress. And I'm very thankful for this. Were it not so, I probably wouldn't be making these tapes. Very likely wouldn't be. But I suggest to you that these things cannot solve the most pressing problem that man faces. And that is man being separated from God, man being under the curse and the penalty of sin, and needing desperately to have a way to come back to God. You know, you can't, it's not a situation where God has drawn a line in the sand here and man was all over on God's side, and then some of the people said, I'm going to go off the devil's side. And they walk across the line and they get over there, and after a few years they come back up right the line. They say to God, I believe we'll just come back over on your side. You just can't do that. God has a divine law. And when he said to Adam and Eve, in the day that you eat of that fruit, you shall surely die, they were separated from God. And they couldn't just turn around and come back and say, oh, Lord, I believe I'll just come on back. There had to be a means of fulfilling divine law and justice. And that's what we're going to be talking about here, the Lord willing, in a little while, I hope, on this chart. So, we cannot just restore ourselves back into covenant relationship with God. Man can put a man on the moon, but he can't break the hold of Satan upon a human soul. Medicine can and has freed the human race from terrible diseases and various afflictions. But medicine cannot free one soul from the guilt and the curse of sin. Education exercises our mind and broadens our horizons, but it cannot rescue man from his moral decline. And so, in Genesis 9 through 11, we see man going down again. But God has a plan. And my dear friends, I am so thankful to tell you that Almighty God has a great and marvelous plan whereby His creatures can be restored to fellowship with Him. What more wonderful thing could I say to you? What greater news could ever be flashed across the wire? God has a plan. God has a marvelous, glorious scheme whereby He's going to make it possible for His people, His creatures, to come back and be in fellowship with Him. That's what this is about. That's what the claims of Jesus of Nazareth are about. And I'm going to ask you to be patient with me while I read some things from you, from Genesis 12 beginning. And we're going to see that God, in the midst of all of this chaos now that has been created by the people trying to build a tower to heaven and so forth, that as time progresses, we come on into the 12th chapter of Genesis, and we find that God is beginning to implement this plan. He's starting to work toward bringing this wonderful thing into existence. And He calls on a man named Abraham. Abraham lived down in Ur of the Chaldees. And he was a real man, in the sense that these are not just stories. People know where this city was. That they, archaeological evidence has shown. And so God spoke to Abraham, and we're going to take up reading the 12th chapter of Genesis and read the first three verses. Then we're going to go on and we're going to read a few verses out of several different chapters all the way down to Genesis 22. Now, I don't have much time left, but I hope I can do this reading before this tape ends, and then we'll take up in the next one and go with it. Genesis 12, 1 through 3. Now the Lord had said to Abram, that was his name and when He first called him, He later changed it to Abraham, "Get out of your country, from your family, and from your father's house, to a land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." Now, Genesis 13. What we're going to see here is that God renews these promises to Abraham as He continues to work with him. And we're going to get some of this history, hopefully a little bit later. But now I'm going to chapter 13, verses 14 through 17. "And the Lord said to Abram, after Lot had separated from him, 'Lift up your eyes now and look from the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, and westward. For all the land which you see, I will give to you and your descendants forever. And I will make your descendants as the dust of the earth, so that if a man could number the dust of the earth, then your descendants also could be numbered. Arise, walk in the land to its length and its width, for I will give it to you.'" Now, come on over to chapter 15 with me. Verse 13 beginning. Then he said to Abram, know certainly that your descendants will be strangers in a land that is not theirs, and will serve them, and they will afflict them 400 years. And also the nation whom they serve I will judge afterward. This nation whom they serve I will judge. Semicolon. Afterward they shall come out with great possessions. Now as for you, you shall go to your fathers in peace, and you shall be buried in a good old age. But in the fourth generation they shall return here, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet complete. Okay, now I want to read the 18th verse of that chapter. On the same day the Lord made a covenant with Abraham, saying, thus and thus. He made a covenant with him. We'll talk about that in the Lord's will. Now, jumping right quick over to chapter 17, verses 7 and 8. And I will establish my covenant between me and you and your descendants after you in their generations. This is God talking to Abraham again. For an everlasting covenant to be God to you and your descendants after you. Also, I give to you and your descendants after you the land in which you are a stranger, all the land of the Canaanite, all the land of Canaan as an everlasting possession, and I will be their God. Now, lastly, Genesis 22, verses 1 through 3. And it came to pass after these things that God tested Abraham and said to him, here am I. And God tells him that he wants him to go up on the mountain and offer his son as a sacrifice. And Abraham goes right to the point of killing this young man, Isaac. And after that, then, we read here in the 15th through the 18th verses of chapter 22. Then the angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time out of heaven and said, by myself have I sworn, says the Lord, because you have done this thing, I have not withheld, and have not withheld your son, your only son. Blessing I will bless you, and multiplying I will multiply your descendants as the stars of the heaven, and as the sand which is on the seashore. And your descendants shall possess the gate of their enemies. And now watch verse 18. In your seed all the nations of the earth shall be blessed, because you have obeyed my voice. I'm glad I got all that read in this tape, because I hope you'll be studying and thinking on them before we come into the next study. We're going to talk about God giving four great promises to Abraham. I'll probably write them up here on our chart, and we'll talk about each one of them and show you how that God gave three of these promises in order that he might keep the fourth. But I believe our time is about up on the tape. So that would be a good place for us to stop on that one. Again, I sincerely appreciate your interest in these studies.